Capitalism, in its early days, saw in the colonies a source of raw materials, which once turned into manufactured goods, could be distributed on the European market. After a phase of accumulation of capital, capitalism has today come to modify its conception of the profit-earning capacity of a commercial enterprise. A blind domination founded on slavery is not, economically speaking, worthwhile. The colonies have become a market. Today, the colonized country's national struggle crops up in a completely new international situation. What the factory owners and finance magnates of the mother country expect from their government is not that it should decimate the colonial peoples, but that it should safeguard their own legitimate interests. The private companies put pressure on their own governments, at least to set up military bases for the purpose of assuring protection of their interests. Thus, there exists a sort of detached complicity between capitalism and the violent forces which blaze up in a colonial territory. For centuries, the capitalists have behaved in the underdeveloped world like nothing more than war criminals. Deportations, massacres, forced labor, and slavery have been the main methods used by capitalism to increase its wealth, its gold or diamond reserves, and to establish its power. Not long ago, Nazism transformed the whole of Europe into a veritable colony. The governments of European nations called for reparations and demanded the wealth which had been stolen from them. Cultural treasures, pictures, sculptures, and stained glass have been given back to their owners. The wealth of the imperial countries is our wealth too. Europe has stuffed herself excessively with the gold and raw materials of the colonial countries, Latin America, China, and Africa. From all these continents, under whose eyes Europe today raises up her tower of wealth, there has flowed out for centuries towards that same Europe diamonds and oil, silk and cotton, wood and exotic products. Europe is literally the creation of the Third World. The wealth which smothers her is that which was stolen from the underdeveloped peoples. The well-being and the progress of Europe have been built up with the sweat and the dead bodies of Negroes, Arabs, Indians, and the Asian races. We have decided not to overlook this any longer. They will not manage to divide the progressive forces which mean to lead mankind toward happiness by brandishing the threat of a third world which is rising like the tide to swallow up all Europe. The third world does not mean to organize a great crusade of hunger against the whole of Europe. What it expects from those who for centuries have kept it in slavery is that they will help it to rehabilitate mankind and make humanity victorious everywhere, once and for all. Specialized in the Negro slave trade and owe their renown to millions of deported slaves. So when we hear the head of a European state declare with his hand on his heart that he must come to the aid of the poor, underdeveloped peoples, we do not tremble with gratitude. Quite the contrary. We say to ourselves, it's a just reparation which will be paid to us. This help should be the ratification of a double realization. The realization by the colonized peoples that it is their due, and the realization by the capitalist powers that in fact they must pay. But it is clear that we are not so naive as to think that this will come about with the cooperation and the goodwill of the European governments. This huge task, which consists of reintroducing mankind into the world, the whole of mankind, will be carried out with the indispensable help of the European peoples, who themselves must realize that in the past, they have often joined the ranks of our common masters. To achieve this, the European peoples must first decide to wake up and shake themselves, use their brains, and stop playing the stupid game of the sleeping beauty.